Let's send emails with PowerShell and SendGrid. Hello everyone, I'm Travis and this is Seraltos. In the olden days of IT, when we needed a script to send an email, we'd relay off an email server that had port 25 open, typically one we controlled. But email has moved to the cloud and open email relays aren't really a good idea. In this video, we look at a more reliable option using SendGrid with PowerShell to send email from our scripts and automation jobs. Before that, please like, subscribe, and share with a friend. Go ahead, I'll wait. You can also become a member for early access to videos ad-free while private, and check out my courses on Azure Virtual Desktop and hybrid identities with Windows AD and Azure AD on udemy.com. The links are below. Hey, wait, I also launched a newsletter. The link to sign up is below. Your support is appreciated. Back to it. SendGrid is a SaaS email service offered by Twilio, available from the Azure Marketplace. There are multiple tiers available based on the amount of email sent. The lowest is a free tier that allows up to 100 emails a day. I can afford that one. That's what we'll use in this video. SendGrid uses an API, not port 25, to send messages. This is more secure than an open email relay. We can leverage SendGrid for any automation or application that needs to send an email. As long as the program or script can access the internet, it can send email. Coming up, we'll start by creating a free SendGrid account. Then we'll use a PowerShell function that allows us to specify the to, subject, and body of the email, and send the message through SendGrid, both with plain text and HTML. The idea with this example is the function can be added to other automation tasks so they can send emails. For example, maybe you want to know when a job is finished or get a message if there's an error. The PowerShell code used for the example coming up is available on GitHub. The link is below. Check out the newsletter, sign up while you're down there. Let's move to the Azure portal to get started. Here we are at the Azure portal. Let's search for Twilio SendGrid. There it is. Select your subscription and resource group. I'll create a new resource group for this example. SendGrid RG. Select your region, Central US for this example. Give it a name, SendGrid Demo for this example. We'll use the free 100 option. If you need to send more email, go to Change Plan. And there we can see our options. Let's close that. We'll leave reoccurring billing as is and go to Next to Tags. Add tags as needed and go to Review and Subscribe. This is a third-party SaaS service and we have to provide some contact information to activate. Let's scroll down. If that all looks good, subscribe. That gets the process started. The deployment is complete, but we're not done yet. We need to configure our account on the SendGrid site. Go to Configure Account Now. We'll sign in. We need to approve Twilio's SendGrid permissions to update data in Azure. Click Yes at the prompt. We need to provide some more information to SendGrid. This is a free account, but nothing's really free, is it? Fill out the form to get started. Once it's up to date, click Get Started. This takes us to the configuration page. We can create a single sender or authenticate a domain. We'll create a single sender for this example. Click Create a Single Sender. Here we need to add some additional sender information. This is required to comply with anti-spam laws. Fill out the information and click Create. You do need to use a real reply address. There is a verification process. We'll click Create. And we'll close the Sender Has Been Created message. One thing to notice right away is under Verified, we've got a red X, meaning it's not verified yet. Let me check the email account of the address used for verification. I got the verification message to that address. Let's open up the verification link in another tab. And now the sender's verified. Let's close that tab. We'll come back to the original tab and refresh. And here it shows the sender is verified now. Now that we have our information verified, we can create the API key. Let's go to API keys under settings. We'll create a new API key. We'll give it a name. We'll call this API key SendGrid Demo. And we can use restricted access. We can do a lot more with the API than just send emails. But for this example, we'll just use the restricted access. Under mail send, we'll give it the ability to send email. Let's go to create and view. And now we have the API key. We're going to copy by clicking on it. Save this key. You won't be able to access the key once we leave this page. If you lose the key, a new API key will have to be created. We'll save it and click done. Let's move on to the function next. We'll need the API key and the sender email address to complete the next steps. Let's go into VS Code. Here we are in VS Code. Let's take a look at the function. I included some information about the function, including four parameters. We need a destination address, the subject, the content type. Content type is optional and set to text plain by default. Finally, we have the content body. This is the actual message in text or HTML format. Let's scroll down to update the SendGrid API key. Add the API key from SendGrid and add the from email address. And this has to be that verified address. If you add a fake email address, like do not reply, you'll get an authentication error and the email won't send. Next, the function creates the header with the API authentication information. Then it assembles the body with the destination address, subject, content type, and body we passed in. Then it converts the body to JSON in a try-catch block. It will error with a message if the conversion fails. Then it uses invoke-restmethod, passing in the SendGrid send mail URI with the method post, along with a header and the body for the message. This is also in a try-catch block. Let's select and run the entire function to add it to memory. Be sure you updated the API key and the from email address. We'll hit F8, or you can do right-click, run selection. And again, that just adds it to memory. So now if we use get help and call the SendGrid email function, we get the help information for that function. That just means it's loaded into memory and now it's available to use. Let's scroll down. Next, we'll send our first email. This one will be text-based. Add the destination email address along with the subject and the contents. This example uses splatting to pass in parameters. The formatting is easier to read this way. Splatting is a hash table of parameters passed into the function. The last line calls the function send-sendgridEmail, then passes in the parameters we added to the splat hash table. Let's highlight and run this. After a couple seconds, you should get an email in the inbox sent from the function and SendGrid. Let's scroll down to the next example. I'm not a web developer, and this code proves it. I created a multi-line string variable and assigned it to the HTML body. I have a table with a header. For some reason, I centered all this. Remember, this is just meant as an example. Update it with whatever you see fit. Let's make the window a little bigger. Next is our destination email address and subject. The content type is text HTML for this example. The content type defaults to text plain if we don't update it. After that, we pass in the content body. That's the HTML body we added above. Let me update the email address. Next, we'll highlight this block of code and run. There are no errors. After a few seconds, we should see the message in our inbox. Notice this time it's formatted with HTML. That is how to use PowerShell and SendGrid to send emails.
This video scratches the surface on what we can do with SendGrid. I hope it helps you better understand the basic task of using SendGrid and PowerShell to send email. Please don't forget to like and subscribe, and thanks for watching.